Professor Klobone has a master and PhD of science and technology, and his major was optoelectronics. So he has quite experience in this field. And his working experience includes Nokia Research Center and also like Nokia Telecom, Helsinki University of Technology. And of course, he stands now as a professor in optics lab from the Department of Physics in TUT. In 2006, he was a visitor on Max Planck Institute for Biophysical Chemistry and group, who is leader by Stefan Kell's group, which is the one of the Nobel Prizes of the last year. So let's welcome you, Happy Women, and well, not literally, but microphone is all yours. So welcome. We have 45 minutes and 15 questions.
Gracias, Mrs. Buenos días. Soy Juha Toivonen de Finlandia, and that's about all my Spanish. Yeah, so Victor did visit our lab as a postdoc 2 years, and that's why I'm pretty much here to also learn about the optics in Mexico. That's my first time in Mexico, so it's really nice to see your country, of course, quite shortly, and now the hurricane is hitting, so the weather is maybe not the best, but still it's really pleasant to be here. I will talk research done in our lab in Tampere in Finland. I picked there a few things just to rise up some topics, but I try to give also like a general overview about what kind of things we do in a lab there. So Tampere is located in northern Europe, in Finland. Finland is here in a country between Sweden and Russia. And it's probably stated to be the biggest inland Nordic city, which is not very big though. So the most biggest cities in the Nordic, Northern Europe is located in a coastline because of the historical reasons. Tampere is here a little bit in the inland, and it has a little bit over 200,000 inhabitants, so it's kind of a really small city, but it's still the biggest inland. So mostly the country is a forest and then the lakes, and that's it. But there is still some optics in Tampere. Here is an overview of the town area. So this is how Tampere looks like. Okay, so we have a technical university there in Tampere, and optics is one of the main research areas in that university. It's highly supported there and focused on many areas. And we have optics related topics in a Department of Physics where I come from, in an optics laboratory. But we also have optics in the chemistry and bioengineering department, and then we have a whole separate unit for optoelectronics, which is more than semiconductor related optics and also fiber laser things. So there is optics in many different categories in our university, but I will now more talk about the optics in the physics department where I come from. And here our laboratory of optics is divided into three different groups. So I try to pick one topic from each group to a little bit explain what kind of research we do there. Of course, there is a strong collaboration between all the units there in the university. So the optics laboratory in physics, there is now 4 professors, but actually only 3 research groups, in a sense that the Gaetano Asanto from University of Roma is more like visiting us as a so-called Filipro professor. It's kind of a special funding in Finland that they every year keep few positions out so that that the visiting professor can come to Finland, let's say a few months per year,
and set up a research group in Finland. So that's why we have four professors currently.
And he does mostly nonlinear optics on liquid crystals, and that's the topic I don't have anything today. But I want to concentrate on these three research groups that we have there. There's a ultrafast optics group run by Jyri Kenti, and he mostly concentrates on spatial and temporal control of light, very often in a fiber-based medium, but also some other mediums, usually guided mediums for the light. Then there is Professor Martti Kauranen's group on nonlinear optics, which is then more like concentrating on nonlinear materials and techniques, which is I pick up today the nonlinear microscopy part of my talk. And then there is my group on spectroscopy and applications, where we try to utilize some of the techniques developed here, but also then other basic spectroscopy techniques, develop them further and solve some issues that the Finnish industry might have. So we have also a lot of industrial cooperation with this in my group. Other groups are more like academic, and there is not industrial cooperation. But this is how our lab consists. There is some group photo. Ulysses is still there at that time. And the staff consists of the senior scientists as professors. Then there is something around 5 postdocs currently, and 13 PhD students, and then 9 undergraduate Master of Science students. So that's pretty much the structure. So it's a kind of a young, the age structure is quite young, because we have most of the people are Master of Science or PhD students, and then there is only like 9 people now there in a senior and postdoc level. So it's a university lab where there is a lot of students. And we also have a lot of foreign nationals in the lab. There is a 5 from France, which is a funny coincidence kind of. Then there's 2 from Italy, Poland, Philippines, Nepal, Iran, Germany, India. So we have people from many places. Mostly because of our university is quite small compared to the activities that we have in optics. So we need to get people outside to be able to run so many activities. The students of our own is not enough to cover all those activities, not even close. So in our lab, it's something almost half of the employees are foreign. Okay, so let's move now to some scientific topics. I first start with this ultrafast optics stuff that Jyri Kenti runs, and he does a lot of things on the control of light dynamics in different medium, and he uses as a tool modeling and then also experiments. So it's quite a unique kind of group in that sense. I think that they have a really high level simulation models on the dynamic and soliton effects on different medium, but also they do the experimental verification of the effects that they are studying. So very much of their work relate to instabilities and noise in different kind of dynamic media, and one example of that is a super continuum generation where this noise is kind of a limiting factor often for the sources to be used in a real applications. So here is some not so safe picture of laser safety on the lab of super continuum. These safety glasses are not enough when you have all the measurements there, so don't try that at home. But in the super continuum sources,
he concentrates mostly on the mid-infrared region where there is not so much commercial sources available yet, and also then the coherence properties of the sources, which is related to the noise figures. And sometimes you want to have really incoherent source, sometimes you want to have a coherent source, and there is a lot of activity on this area currently in his group. And they study these coherence properties, for example, by measuring spectra of individual pulses and see how they develop from pulse to pulse, the spectral shape and things like that. And then we have used also his sources in a spectroscopy. So this is more like collaboration with my group and his group on the how to utilize these supercontinuum sources on spectroscopy. Here we had a source which produced the light from was it around 2 micron to 3.5 micron in a wavelength. And then we put there a gas sample where there was carbon dioxide and acetylene was the gases there that we were measuring, and then the spectrum of those gases is shown in the where the supercontinuum light is then recorded by a spectrometer. So just to demonstrate that this kind of light source can be used for spectroscopy, and if you compare that for a thermal radiation source that is usually used for FTIR spectroscopy, for example, then the main benefit with the supercontinuum source, of course, is that you have a laser beam kind of light source that you can put it travel long distances or couple it to cavity or doing some multipass arrangement or things like that, which you can very easily do with a lamp. Okay, then on his topic, I picked this white light interferometry as a one topic that I try to describe a little bit more in detail. Let's see how I managed to do that. But then there is also this temporal coast imaging that he's doing currently, but I don't like to go there because I can't explain what's happening in there. Okay, but this optical coherence tomography is a technique that is used to measure depth profile of a certain samples. And you can do it, of course, many ways by measuring scattering. If you have a pulsed source, you can measure scattering from the sample, and then you have a depth profile from scattering from different distances. But how it's usually doing nowadays is an interferometric way, so that you have a white light continuous wave source, and then there is an interferometer that records the interferogram in the intensity camera or signal point detector, and then from this interferogram the depth profile is calculated. And a little bit faster way to do it is do it the same thing in a frequency domain, so you don't need to move the mirror in the interferometry. You can use a still reference mirror, put the white light in, your sample is here, and then you do the detection with the spectrometer, and then from this interferogram recorded by the spectrometer, you can have a depth profile recording in the sample. So that's OCT. Why this is interesting for the group doing supercontinuum is, of course, that supercontinuum can be used as a light source here. And why to use supercontinuum as a light source is related to the resolution of the OCT, because the more that you have width in the band, more you have resolution in the depth profile. So this is a equation describing the resolution in the z direction profiling, and there is a wavelength, of course, that you use, but also then the bandwidth of the light that you have in the white light source. So if you have a broader band, then you can solve narrower lines in the profile, and that's why supercontinuum sources are studied, because they of course give you a possibility to make a much broader light source there compared to LEDs, for example. Then this work that they have recently published is related about the dispersion control in the white light interferometry, because especially when you are starting to take more and more wavelength band in the measurement,
then different wavelengths are having different refractive index in the beam path, and that will cause you distortion in the signal. But they have developed here an approach with actually in collaboration with Ari Freeberry that you mentioned. He's part of this work also, where they use kind of a dual detector. So there's the interferometry is built in a way that the white light source is directly the sample, but now you don't have just a single detector here, but the interferometer is constructed in a way that you can couple two detectors there and measure the coherence of these two detection channels. There is a little bit more complicated reference arm here with a cubic beam splitter here or mirror, so that the dispersion in these beam paths can be compensated, so that this light that travels here goes similar length in the glass, inside of the glass, than the beam that travels here. So in this point, both of them have been traveled equal distance in the glass, and then they go to the detectors. And with this arrangement, you end up to calculate the correlation between these two detectors. And let's say that they have recorded this kind of interferogram there in the both detectors. And now if you have some distortion here with the dispersion, then this curve is like distorting in another end. And for example, the peak density is higher in another end than in another end. So there is some distortion in the optical length. But in this calculation of the coherence, you have different signs in the frequency here. So that what you do is kind of a convolution of these two waveforms. So you flip this around and multiply with this each other. And now if you have some distortion on this end here, then in this graph it's now in this end here, and that kind of compensates it in the calculation of this product here. So that's the main idea behind of dispersion compensation, that when you have a two detectors there and you calculate the coherence function between them. And the experimental setup was built like this, that you have a sample just a plane mirror there. So it's kind of a delta function, you have only one distance to measure. And then they put the dispersive medium here in between to like distort the measurement. In this case it was just a block of glass in a beam path. And then the spectrum of the both detector is recorded with the monochromator. And what you end up with was a pretty good cancellation of the dispersion. So here you see the normal, this graph is a little bit complicated because there is too much stuff in here, but you can pretty much pocket everything from zero to that end because it's just a mirror of the Fourier transform, and then this is the zero frequency peak. So actually everything from that point on the right is your actual signal here. And this blue curve here shows the delta function of the distance where the mirror is attached there. And now if you use a normal OCT mode, so only using one detector, this dispersive medium, the block of glass, changes the resolution from original 23 microns to about 60 microns. So it ruins the measurements quite badly. But then, if you do the same thing with the two detectors, and in this coincidence calculation, you cancel quite well the dispersion, and the delta function is imaged much more accurately, and the resolution keeps almost the same, or actually better in this case, but that's probably mostly due to the inaccuracy in the measurement. But the dispersion, extra dispersion in a beam path does not affect the resolution there. So that's that's the main advantage that can be done with this kind of two detector measurement in the OCT. This is not too much about the ultra-fast dynamics But I didn't pick those topics of his group because I cannot explain them too well.
Okay, but then let's move to another group in our lab. That's a group of Professor Martti Kauranen doing a nonlinear optics on nanostructures and metamaterials. And also then applying these nonlinear methods in an imaging mode. So he has a lot of like fundamental research on nonlinear interactions in a bulk material surface, nanostructures, how the nonlinear effects behave, and also not how the quadrupole behavior of the material creates different responses in the different structures. And there are a lot of different materials that they use in the nonlinear studies, and one of them is now the liquid crystals that our PhD professor is running there from Italy. But normally, I think the most typical structures they use is some kind of a metallic nanostructures or metamaterials which are fabricated by electron beam lithography, not in our lab, but in a collaborating labs like this optoelectronics laboratory or then another university where they have better facilities for nanofabrication. So they collaborate with many groups and get samples from them, and then they do the optical characterization and studies with those samples then. Also some organic materials is included. And what is special then in the microscopy that they do with the nonlinear effects is that they use these kind of higher order polarization modes to control the vectorial polarization field in the focus spot of the microscope. So this is a schematic view of how it looks like. So when you have a tight focusing on a microscope objective, then the polarization is not so well defined anymore in a focal point, and you can actually, with the proper selection of the inputting polarization modes, you can also create the polarization in the direction of the beam travel, so in a set direction of the beam, so-called, so that you have polarization in a direction where the beam goes. And that really changes the nonlinear response in many, many structures, like in the surface where normally you have a forbidden nonlinear transitions, then this polarization might allow you to get a response from those surfaces, for example. And then they have used this nonlinear microscopy on many kind of samples, which I try to present a little bit a summary that what kind of things they can do with the nonlinear microscopy. So nonlinear microscopy, the NLO abbreviation here means nonlinear optics. So the nonlinear microscopy can be several different things, more than actually this one here, that can be stimulated Raman and cars and those kind of processes which are not shown here. But what is done in our lab is mostly second harmonic generation microscopy, third harmonic generation microscopy, and then some 4-MeV mixing studies, but not so much. So mainly it's concentrating on these second and third harmonic generation and how they can be used in imaging in certain structures. And to get these processes effective, you need to use pulsed source with some femtosecond laser and high intense pulses. And then the good point, of course, if you image, for example, a biological sample, that you don't need to have a label of molecules as in a fluorescence microscopy, so you just image the structure as it is. In a second harmonic generation, you normally probe non-sensor symmetric things, and third harmonic acceleration you can probe some interfaces, and in interfaces are very often interested in nanostructures. So this is an example of now the polarization fields that they usually use. So the conventional fields, linear and circle polarization, it's definitely of course there as a reference. So in some cases you get the response that you want with the linear or circular polarization in the sample. But then they also have implemented the possibility to use asymptotic polarization and radial polarization, where you have a kind of a donut-shaped beam going to the microscope objective, so there is no light intensity in the center. So it's kind of donut-shaped white field where your polarization state is different around the circle. So in asymptotic polarization, you have a linear polarization here, but then the state of the linear polarization changes when you go around the circle. But if you detect it in a one point, there you have a linear polarization. Same thing in a radial polarization mode, but here it's just 90 degree difference, so the polarization vector is pointing to the center of the domed ring. And there, in this nonlinear microscopy, the polarization direction is have a really big effect on the signal generation. So then some structures you can by utilizing all these four different polarization modes, you can get a better clue about what kind of structure you are imaging, depending on what kind of signal different modes are generating. For example, in this example of radial polarization, this one creates the strong polarization in a Z direction, and then you get the component in a in a Z direction in the polarization field. This is how the nonlinear microscopy setup looks like. There is just a commercial femtosecond laser as a starting point, and all these optics that you have on this side of the table is used to modify the beams, creating the polarization states and cleaning the beams to be a good 10-0-0 mode and everything like that. And then there is a kind of a black hole in between, and then the actual microscopic part is then on this side. So the beams are directed here underneath, and then the microscope objective is here underneath, and the beams hit the sample here in the states. And to keep the polarization mode clean, the beam is not scanned in the imaging, but the beam is just stable, and then the sample is in a holder that can scan the position in the sample. And then there is another objective on top here that is actually just a normal bright field microscopy to find the position in the sample that you want to measure more easily. So that's the setup, and very often they use wavelengths around 800 to 1064 in that range. 1064 because many studies has been done on the neodymium-yak wavelengths, and it's easy to reference to those studies if you use the same wavelength here, even though the TISAC here is now then tunable. And this is then some examples of what kind of samples they have imaged. There is a second harmonic imaging in the samples where the central symmetric is broken, like a metal nanostructures which are artificially produced. These ones actually in Germany, so they get the samples from elsewhere. But then they were able to show that this chirality really tunes the signal there nicely. Then they have also published a work where they image the single carbon nanotubes
in this kind of a gap here, and
also in that case the central symmetry is broken, and it creates a second harmonic signal. Even if the carbon nanotube is of course like a really narrow in a nanometer scale, but in optical microscopy image it looks like a some 200-300 nanometer bit because of the diffraction limit in the microscope. So that's the smallest features that can be solved with the microscope.
They have also done studies on some biological samples, which I don't know that much about, but there is a increasing interest to go on biological samples because with nonlinear microscopy you don't need to label the sample, but you can get an image from undisturbed specimen, and especially when you can control the polarization modes, you can probe the what kind of interfaces you have in the cellular sample, for example, and that's getting interesting for biologists.
From my point of view, I think most interesting work is on the semiconductor nanostructures and metallic nanostructures that they have shown that they can emit a second harmonic and third harmonic generation in these kind of nanostructures, and to be able to use that as a characterization tool then for nanostructures, maybe used in some other application.
So this shows the difference. If you have a azimuthal polarization or the radial polarization, the mechanism how the response is generated is quite different, and then on the shape of these different responses with different polarization field, you can get a better clue that how your nanostructure look like. And you can also identify then defects. So if you have a nanostructure which is having some defect in it, then it really easily result in a change in a nonlinear microscopy response. So it can be used as a characterization tool also for the nanostructures.
Here they have imaged the single nanopilars. This is a multiple nanopilars. This is like single nanopilars that they have built.
Another group, the semiconductor group, has built on top of the gallium arsenide wafer, and then they can get the different response on those nanopilars.
Okay, that's pretty much what I had on the work of the other groups in our lab. They do a lot of more things, but I'm not able to describe them. And I think now it's time to move on the things that my group do, and what kind of applications we do in a applied optics group. So our tools are all kind of spectroscopy techniques which we then try to enhance to be better, and also try to find new applications for them. There is quite a lot of activity in the past in our group on the combustion monitoring. So this is a schematic picture of a big power plant where we have some 10 meter distance and then lasers going through it. That's because in Finland there is three big manufacturers of the combustion power plants, which is used in a waste incineration or then biomass incineration. Also some of them still in a fossil fuel, but less nowadays. And most of the research problem they have are related to this new kind of fuels, which are much more heterogeneous and lower quality than the previous fossil fuels, which was all the same quality all the time. Now if they burn, for example, demolition wood or some waste, the quality of the fuel changes all the time, and they need to have a new feedback from the system, and that's where we use lasers. And also other industrial detection methods.
One topic that we have, which is not about the detection but more like laser driving, is a little bit by accident found a mechanism where we can use bright fluorescent structures on the polymer film. So we have done it in two different polymers now, and it seems that it works in many kind of polymers. We mix there some metallic ion, in this case silver ion on the liquid polymer. Then it's spin coated on the sample, and then afterwards by a laser you can use two photon or single photon excitation. You can cause a reduction of the silver by exciting silver atoms, by reduced silver start to form clusters, and when two silver atoms forms a silver cluster, it turns to be fluorescent. So these few atom clusters, metal clusters, are like fluorescent quantum dots, or like molecules, how you would say. And that's what happens in the process here, when you illuminate that with the light. And you can do that in every material system, but the problem is that when you illuminate that with the light, the process just continues and continues, and the silver cluster grows and grows, and then it turns to metal. So then it's not anymore fluorescent and active in that sense. So what the polymer does here is that it stabilizes the growth so that the only few atoms can be linked together, and then we can end up to have a fluorescent structures. So this is a fluorescent image on this laser written area. So by doing a laser writing, we can activate those areas to be fluorescent, and then use that in some kind of marking applications, for example. And they turn to be really photostable because of the nature of these nanoclusters. They doesn't bleed very easily. What else we do? There's one field that we have been doing now 7-8 years on optical imaging of radioactive sources. That's actually a very rare topic, and not very many groups work on that area. And we have recently published some maybe 6 papers on this area that makes us as the most publishing group in the area of this narrow area, and that kind of shows that there is not that much activity in the field. But there is a lot of interest in the nuclear community, because they need to start dismounting old nuclear facilities, and for that they need to clean the old processing facilities and power plants, and it's quite hard to localize where the contamination is, and optics can help there. So there's a good methods to measure the amount of radioactivity, but there is not very good methods to localize where it's coming from. But what happens around the radioactive source, these pellets here are nuclear fuel. They emit ionizing radiation, which ionized air around this radioactive particle, and then this ionized air produces fluorescence. So in air you have mostly nitrogen, so what we can detect optically is the nitrogen fluorescence. And that's what we have done here in this picture. We have a combined a normal photograph with the UV fluorescence emits which is filtered so that it only records the nitrogen fluorescence line, and when those two figures are combined, then we can localize it that where is the radioactive sources. We also have done a project on Doppler shift measurements, where also Victor uses good work, and there we have tried different methods. That's mainly because there is one big metrology company, Vaisala, in Finland, who wants to develop techniques on this area. So we have been collaborating with them on the Doppler shift measurement with the laser. And then we have also work going on the elemental analysis, which is done with the laser induced breakdown spectroscopy, so-called LIP spectroscopy, where elemental concentration in the sample can be recorded. In this case here, there is a signal recorded as a function of concentration of zinc in the sample, but we have not studied too much of the conventional liquid, the solid phase method, but we have been targeting to develop sensitive methods for liquids measurements. So how you can measure elemental concentration, trace metals or trace elements in liquid, which is mostly some impurities like heavy metals also. And in the coming, I have some more detailed slides about this technology we have developed here. So, short introduction to LIPS spectroscopy. So you, in this method, you hit the sample with the laser pulse, which ionizes the material and heats it up so that it creates a small plasma plume on the sample. And then when this plasma then expands and cools down after the laser pulse, let's say in a microsecond time window, then these atoms and molecules, mostly atoms and ions, that are here left, they then illuminate the light, which is characteristic for those atoms and ions. And then you, from that fluorescence or that light, you can detect that what elements you have there and how much. And typical spectra look like this, that there is several peaks caused by different elements. And for example, in this case, calcium is showing the normal atomic peak, and then also the ionized calcium gives the ionized peak. Then there's also other metals and semi-metals, which are usually easily seen in the spectrum. And we wanted to focus to develop this technique sensitive for trace metals in liquid samples. So in liquids, the problem is usually that the liquid damps the plasma formation and causes bubbling in the liquid and this laser pulse. And also, the cooling of the plasma is really rapid. So, but it has been done on the surface of the water, as a just surface of the bulk water or some kind of water jet, where on the surface of the water it has been measured. Inside of the water also, but it's no way that you can go on the trace concentration in that way. Typically, people use their quite high energy laser pulses in the even range in 100 microjoule, millijoule, and the detection limits are in a level of 100 ppm typically in liquid of elements. Of course, there is some elements which glow more brightly and they can be detected better, but typically it's limited in this range, 100 milligrams per liter, and that's not enough to measure trace elements in a water in a level that the industry needs. It's for example in the wastewater treatment or even in the industrial processes. So some three orders of magnitude lower would be something that could be usable already. So we should change this milligram here to micrograms. Then we are in a level where it would be likely usable. So our approach here was using a levitating droplet to make the analysis. So we use a technique called electrodynamic balance, which is an old technique from 70s. But what you do in this technique is that you charge a droplet or whatever particle you have, you charge it electrically and direct in this kind of electric field. And then this electric field has so much power on the small droplet or small particle that it can trap the particle in the center here, and then the particle is levitating there in the center of the electric field. And we did it so that we have a piezoelectric
water droplet generator, where we have a electrode plate to charge the droplet when it comes to this electric field area.
And then the water droplet is trapped in the center.
And then we wait a few seconds, because a small droplet in a range of 50-70 micron in a diameter, that evaporates quite fast. So in a few seconds, the water is pretty much disappeared, and we are left with the dry sample, very small though, in a scale of 1 micron or smaller in some cases. But that contains still all the metallic elements. They don't evaporate. So we have a trace elements in this concentrated little particle levitating in our trap. And then we use the LIPS technique to analyze what was the trace metals in this droplet. And that's the way to go to quite good detection limits.
So this is some close-up pictures of the setup. Electrodes are built. This is a millimeters in diameter. The distance is here. So it's in the whole electrode structure is in a scale of 1 centimeter. Then we have optical access to the chamber from six different ports. And here is a picture showing a little particle levitating in a trap. It's illuminated with a green light here, so it scatters the green light from the droplet. The positioning accuracy is quite good, so it stays there in a stable position in accuracy of 1 to 2 micron, which is really nice for LIPS analysis. We can hit the particle every time with the laser pulse in a repeatable way. This is how the chamber looks like if you look it in an optical port. So this is the 1 centimeter electrodes there and then 1 inch optical port looking at in there. And that's also then limiting our collection efficiency of the optics, of course, but still it's enough to make the measurements. Some close-up pictures about this particle in the trap. So these kind of pictures we have also used to determine the stability of the trap, so it really stays there in a stable position. So how the measurement is then constructed is that we use the signal droplet generator here, which is a piezoelectric droplet generator. You can control the piezo with different voltages, but what we typically have had there is a diameter of something like 70 micrometer droplet, which we can image when it goes to the sample area here. And of course it's important to know what is the size of the original droplet, because of the you measure some amount of trace elements with a LIPS spectroscopy, then if you want to know the original concentration in the water, you need to compare that with the original droplet size that you launched on the sample area. And then the optical measurement is done in a way that the LIPS pulse is focused in the center. It evaporates the material there. It's a little bit different now compared to the solid surfaces, because we have a quite limited amount of material there. We only have this micrometer scale drop kind of a trace metal particle there, and not like a continuous surface. So it means that the evaporation after like a 1 millijoule of laser energy, it has evaporated all the material. So even if you put more and more power in the laser, there is nothing more to evaporate. So in this case, we don't benefit that much of using a really large pulse energies like 100 millijoules or so. And yeah, the spectrum is measured by the spectrometer that is next to the chamber. And as I saw already earlier there, that we can then record this kind of calibration curves for different metals. This is done for zinc, and actually with a little bit earlier set up, so there's still some noise here in the data points. Now we have a little bit better control on the track and we can reduce the noise even better. But as you can see here, we can achieve a pretty good dynamic range over several orders of magnitude and still have a linear response. And now the detection limits, the ppms, are now the milligrams per liter. So now we can go there way less than 1 milligram. So we are heading to the microgram region, which is needed for many applications. So this seems really seems to work in the getting into really low concentrations in lipid samples. This is some examples of different metals. For nickel, here in the upper picture, there's a lot of peaks from nickel. You can do the analysis with any of the peaks in principle, but of course it's more beneficial to use the strongest one. In the lead sample, there is a lead peak here for 5 millimeter that we use for analysis, and then the zinc here that I mean, so you saw the calibration curve already. So of course there is a lot of disturbing peaks around, but it's important to find the peak for the analysis that the other matrix doesn't disturb too much. But it seems to work in a similar kind of detection limit for many of these metals that are usually interesting to monitor in an industrial application. Well, we did some more detailed analysis also on how the track performs in the different conditions, how the drying time of the particle affects there, but maybe not going too much details on those. But just so that this analysis of trace elements can be done. And what is then shows here, if you increase the pulse energy in a laser, you actually start to decrease of your signal there. So in our case, we don't benefit on a really large pulse energy lasers, but it's better to work with some 5 millijoule energy range where there is enough to evaporate but not heat up the sample too much. Okay, for that I like to conclude my kind of a large overview of the topics in the optics laboratory, and there was several different things we do, but I hope that I was able to give you some clue of the things that we do in Tampere University of Technology in the Optics Laboratory.
Let's start for a couple of questions. If you have some questions, you can ask the speaker.
This company, Tech, what sort of company is it?
This is actually a funding, governmental funding instrument of technological projects in Finland. So we have two different funding instruments of research in Finland. One is academic fundamental research, and another one is applied research with companies. And this TTS is a kind of a funding instrument for industrial related research. So it's not a company.
Like a
concept,
but for application, for industrial.
Agency for funding.
Yes, exactly.
And what is the criteria they choose for the project? Finland is known because forestry mainly, no?
They have different categories of funding instruments, of course, but it's very often they are looking for some industrial potential for a larger market, so they are not very interested if the solution is something which solves only one problem in one specific area of the industry, but they are looking for developed techniques which can be helpful in many areas. And then main criteria for them to analyze the quality of the proposal is to use companies and company interest there. So we had here also collaborating companies like from mining industry and technology providers for mining industry. So that was the starting point for our studies. In mining industry, they use a lot of water to process the mining ore, and then there is a lot of trace elements of metals in the waters, of course, and that was the starting point of this study a few years ago.
You measured the droplet diameter, the water droplet, by what means? By the fraction or something like that?
It has the scattering and a camera image because it's so large. The droplet is like 70 microns. You can image it just with a CCD camera and the scattering light. So we have there light source which illuminates the area, and the CCD that emits kind of a microscope that takes the image, which is synchronized when we launch the droplet and takes the image at the same time. So that's how we have done it currently. But it seems to be quite stable that if you have same conditions in a piezo generator, then the droplet size seems to be really stable, so it doesn't change.
This foundation, I understand that you have, the foundation give you or ask you some questions about some problems, but I was thinking that this foundation at the end of the or the companies at the end want to get a device that solves the problem, or only put the money to get the know-how at the beginning?
Well, both. Companies do both. They invest money there to get the know-how and learn how things work, but they are in the same time looking for that if there is something beneficial coming out, then they would be interested to license the technology. For example, in this case, it was too difficult kind of technology for these companies to take in a role at that time when we were collaborating with them. So they didn't want to buy the rights for this technology that we developed, and that's why one of my PhD students is currently considering setting up a startup company on developing this technique further. So we have the full rights for the technology currently. When we go in the project originally, the companies who come to support this funding from national agency, they get the right, kind of the first right to buy the licensing rights for the technology. But if they don't use it, then the rights are coming back to the researchers.
So, let's thank again you, Hatoimonen.